Okay, here we go. Here we go. Hey, look. Got notes. I guess we're going to talk about the primaries. I really didn't pay attention to it. Not that much. It's about 2 ounces, supposedly. I had a little bit earlier. Bitters. Moringa bitters. Moringa. I'll tell you about moringa. It's spelled M-O-R-I-N-G-A. It's a plant. It's a leaf. It's off a tree, whatever have you. And bitters. I'm an old man. Old men take bitters. You know what I'm saying? You know, let me put it this way. I'm younger than Bernie and Biden, and I'm older than Barack, but I'm about the same age as Bill Clinton, I think. Around about a couple of years. Supposed to take a bitters before breakfast. I got refried beans and I think turkey sausage. And they're doing something. Okay, so let me take this off. So I can see. Hey, I can see. Okay, I got to go. A little history here. Let me start a little way back, man. I lost faith in faith like I ever had in America, especially with Bush Sr., with the whole SNL scandal. You know, that's where, you know, they played the people, man. They stole people, the bank, they had this SNL savings and loan, then they stole money, and they got away with it for a second. A little bit, people went to jail, but then after that, they changed the law, and now the bankers do what they do, whatever it is. That's why it's getting worse. If you want to know about the wealth gap getting worse, it happened when the bankers changed the rules, you know, because they bought off politicians like they do now. Then my next faith kind of shaking was Clinton. With his campaign, what was that year? This 92. Anyway, he ran his campaign. No worries. But what happened was the platform that they had included D.C. statehood. But when Clinton became president, it was on a Democratic platform, the Democrat platform, and he basically said, "No, we ain't going to do that," which was kind of strange to me because. If we'd had D.C. statehood back in the 90s, 80s even, because I think Jesse had been pushing it since his campaigns in 84, 80, whatever it was. But you would have had two black senators, because back then D.C. was really Chocolate City, and one black congressman automatically. That would have helped the Democrat Party, no? No, I guess not. Anyway, so that went by the way. Then the next big thing, you went to Barack Obama. Now, Barack... You know, as you know, his cabinet was picked by Citibank. You know, he did his whole campaign. You know, he even convinced, when was that turning point? I forgot. I think it's North Carolina or South Carolina. I think it may have been North Carolina. I forget. But anyway, he went to the black ladies at the church, got on his side. Because remember, up until then, you know, Hillary was, you know, that was the favorite. And when the black church women got with him, ooh, that was it. Because you have an institution behind you. This was important. You have to have an institution behind you. Anyway, then he started to take off after that. I guess it was, I don't know when it was, North Carolina, I think it was. But he had a scheme. Well, he betrayed. He was a betrayer. That's the problem. Even his whole, forget black people betraying black. He did his whole progressive, whatever it is. They had this whole thing. They just dismantled that. You look that up. But all throughout his campaign, he dissed black people at every turn. I mean, even that thing that happened with Gates and giving the cop for and having some sort of beer summit, that was a diss to me. Anyway, we'll leave that alone. What else happened? And it's interesting because Barack Obama, to me, he treated black people just like, you know, when those folks come up from the Caribbean or from Africa, it doesn't matter, every place, the Koreans, whatever it is, talk about back in the 90s, then they kept on saying, why can't you black people pick up yourself by the bootstraps? Why can't you? We can do it, we can do it. You know, so he's of that mindset, okay? I'm trying to say he's of that mindset. Okay, let me keep on moving. And if you don't believe me about Barack Obama's betrayal, I happened to read or had the audio book of... Audacity of Hope. And I think I right before I left Cape Town, so I heard it in, well, you know, because it went to Grammy, you know, whatever it is. I think it was like 2000, right before I came in, so 2013. That's when I paid attention to the book. And If you try to read it now, you can see his total betrayal. Everything he said in that thing, he went against. Why? Because I guess he had the Citibank people with him. Okay. Then the next thing, oh, by the way, Barack Obama, man, I called him, I did slick. Somehow I said something, and somebody, this was a long time ago, and somebody said, oh, you know, you shouldn't do that, blah, 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 because, you know, they have this reference, Barack Obama. But the thing is, he was slick then, he's slick now. Come on, you must have heard by now. He's doing a whole lot of behind the scenes thing. Everything from getting Buttigieg to drop out and endorse Biden to bringing Beto, whatever the guy is, O'Rourke back in. You know, all this behind the scenes thing. Talk about behind the scenes thing. Let's keep on going with behind the scenes thing, because remember one of the things he did. Let me jump this right now. Let me jump on this right now. One of the things he did was, you know, Tom Perez, who's the head of the Democratic National Committee, whatever it is, he's the one that got him in there, got him to run, because somebody else was supposed to do the Muslim guy from, the black Muslim guy from, you know, from Detroit or something like that, wherever, Michigan, wherever he was from, right? But Perez came in and all kinds, you know, that's Barack Obama behind that, right? And he's still behind stuff, right? So let me jump to Bernie for a second. So Bernie made several mistakes, right? First mistake is that his people, I don't say allowed, but didn't have enough clout to get that Tom Perez thing not done. Let's put it that way. The other thing that Bernie did messed up with the ADOS conference. Now, well, I'm saying he could have sent, you know, Killer Mike or Nina Turner there. He could have been on video saying, look, I got some other stuff to do, but, you know, I'm blah, blah, here's what I believe. And let me let, you know, Nina or Auntie Nina or Brother Mike, you know, speak to it. But that didn't happen. Because that was at the ADOS conference, as you can see. I got the shirt on. Cornel West was there, but he wasn't advocating. I don't remember him really advocating for Bernie at that particular point, but, you know, it was good that he didn't. But also, the other thing that Bernie did, he called for a revolution. Let me tell you something. When you say revolution, and then when you start running, and then people start socialist, when you say socialist and revolution, they automatically, less old people, when you got that whole, you know, communist, you know, Cuba, Russia thing on the head. And I think that's where he messed up. What he should have did to me, this is what I do. If you look at what, I'm what's called a cultural revolutionary. Now, culture just, to me, revolution is just a revolving thing. So as you have a revolution, you have a counter-revolution. So you're on a spinning wheel, right? But so culturally, I don't believe there's anything new under the sun. You know, when I say culture, I mean like when I'm doing my plays and, you know, and poetry and stuff like that. But as a person, well, I call myself an evolutionary. I'm constantly evolving, you know. So though I'm a boomer, I'm not stuck in boomerton, you know. Because I'm sort of weird because I'm outlier's outlier. I'm in step with every alliteration, that everything that's happened. I mean, everything keeps on happening. I'm right there with it, you know. But I wanted to bring that up only to say that I think, you know, if Bernie was true revolutionary, what he should is coin a new phrase. We're going to evolve everything, blah, 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 blah. So you mess up there. But the thing that really messed up, I learned this from my best friend, who's also a boomer. I was out there in St. Louis last year. I said, you know, just who are you going to vote for? And he was just saying, he didn't mention, I don't know if Biden was even a factor then. But he was saying that he wanted Elizabeth Warren because she was smart or something like that, right? But he said Bernie, he had a heart attack. Hey, remember, this is you know, JB, you know, this guy's, you know, retired lawyer. But I want to tell you, JB, he got credentials. So if he's going to say one of the factors is that Bernie had a heart attack, a lot of people are thinking like that. This old man, why am I going to put this on me? He's going to be dying. So I guess, you know, my hope is to have Bernie would be the thing, and then Elizabeth Warren would, not Elizabeth Warren, Tulsi Gabbard would be the vice president. Bernie died. Tulsi Gabbard, I shouldn't say that. I'm sorry. I apologize. Okay, but the point is, basically, folks ain't going to follow no old white man. Okay, whether you're white, black, whatever, folks are just not going to follow some old white man. That's my assessment of it, right? So it's just my notes here. So that's what I have to say. I mean, you know, so this what is happening with this primary, this Super Tuesday, this is a surprise to me, because old folks, unless you're talking to them, unless you're down there with them, you don't know really what's happening on the ground. I even said something, I made a comment about, you know, folks in South Carolina, but you have to understand, Jim Clyburn, he got that thing sold up. Unless you got a machine that's as good as him going against him, which you don't, you know, then, you know, yeah, you ain't going to win that. And then you don't know how black folks on the ground, especially, are thinking. You don't know what relationships are down there. So I'm not down South Carolina, so I don't know what happened. You know, I can't blame, you know, black folks down South Carolina for doing what they do. I do know I didn't vote in Virginia. It didn't matter. Who won? Biden won Virginia. Even my little thing when they changed that. Andy. But in Virginia, let me tell you what happened. One time I was voting in Virginia, about 3-4 years ago. What they do, right, when you're going in, right, the people that's helping you, usually older, you know, boomer kind of people, and they look and they give you that knowing look, da da da. And if you don't know, if you don't say, I'm going to vote for this, they say, well, you might say, a person might say, well, who should I vote for? And they sort of tell you, you know, vote for this. So I'm sure a lot of these stations, there was a whole lot of Biden-esque, Biden things happening. But I can't prove that, so I shouldn't say anything like that. So anyway, that's my little assessment of that. I listened to Yvette. As you know, I get my marching orders as far as political, what we're doing here at ADUS, from Yvette and Tony. I don't do anything, you know, other than that. I make these comments, but, you know, that's for general political things. There may be some ADUS things because this will be my ADUS playlist. You can see my journey through ADUS from like two years ago. Well, no, last year, February, you can see that journey. Boom, 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 boom. How it comes to this particular point where we are. This is going to be a very interesting season. I want to see what happens, but because I was listening to you, Yvette, and let's see if Bernie's camp gets a ding moment and say, wait a second, we got to adjust. Let's see if they can adjust, because, you know, old people, they're not like me. It takes them a while to adjust. Let's put it that way. So let me say, I guess say something personal right now. I'm sort of like, I'm hearing New York, you know what I mean? And basically, I had to spend a lot of money for certain things, whatever have you. So I'm on like a really tight budget. So please, Yvette, do not put the tickets for ADUS conference on sale this month. You got to wait till my Social Security check, my thing coming at the end of the month, then I can pay for it. So please, don't do anything yet, okay? Just a little suggestion or a little, you know, request from me. T from the Patterson's taking a train to Tibet, letting you know what I only suspect from a little ADOS reality. That would be reality right here. Talk to you soon.